Thank you for coming. The disappearance of Michael Modesti was today declared a major crime, and police believe, unfortunately, that Michael was most likely murdered. On the 10th of May 2016, Michael Modesti was reported missing by his brother, and at the time he'd been living at 12 Willsmore Street at Beverley. He was a tiler by trade. He had a four-year-old son who he loved very much and had a very close relationship with his family. From the outset, police had grave concerns because of the circumstances of this case and investigated in hope that we would find Michael alive and well and that he disappeared for some harmless reasons. Unfortunately, as time's gone on, the likelihood of that has diminished to the point where we now think the possibility of Michael being alive is non-existent, and we believe that he was murdered. Michael is known to police for some strife he got into between 2002 and 2006, but certainly in recent years there have been very little interaction with the police other than for some traffic matters. We have an open mind as to what may have happened to Michael, but certainly one of the lines of investigation that we are pursuing is that this may in some way be a drug-related murder. And we haven't been able to find anything to exclude that possibility at this stage, although, as I say, we're keeping an open mind. I can give you a bit of a timeline of what we know of Michael's last movements, and which I expect would be helpful to people who know him and for people who may be able to help fill in some of those gaps. On the 26th of April, so on Tuesday the 26th of April, Michael flew to Thailand. We're not sure who he went with, but we're told that he went there to attend a building expo, and he was exploring the possibility of importing silicon for use in the tiling industry. We're unable to confirm whether he in fact did attend the expo, but we do know that he arrived in Bangkok and that he travelled on to Pattaya. We don't know who was involved in that venture with him, and we'd ask that anybody with information or has any knowledge of the business that Michael was proposing to set up, who may have travelled with him or have any knowledge at all about that venture, to contact us immediately. On Thursday the 6th of May, we know that Michael returned to Adelaide, and after returning, the first thing he did was to go to his partner at Brooklyn Park. And later that night, his partner and son stayed with him for the weekend at his home. The weekend was taken up pretty well with Michael doing all the things you would expect a dad to do with their four-year-old son. And from everything we've heard, they had a very enjoyable weekend together. We know on Sunday the 8th, at 1:19 p.m, Michael attended Welland Plaza Shops, where he withdrew a small amount of money from the ready teller, and his attendance was captured on CCTV. At 2:45 the same day, his car was seen travelling along North Terrace in the vicinity of the casino. And at 5:30, he dropped his son off to his mum at Evanston Gardens. We know at 7:30 that Michael ordered a pizza to be delivered to his house, and that a short time later that arrived, and at 10:45 that night he spoke to his partner on the telephone, and after a brief conversation he basically retired for the night. We know on Monday the 9th of May that at 3:35 Michael's car was definitely not in Chanel Street at West Croydon. And we know that because a taxi driving along Torrens Road has been located, and they have dash cam vision which shows the street that's being cleared. At about 5:30, a person walking in the area saw the car there, and they're certain it was the car because it's not normally parked in that location. And again later that day at 1:35 p.m, a passing motorist with dash cam recorded the presence of Michael's car. On the Monday afternoon, Michael's partner advised the family that she was concerned and hadn't been able to contact Michael, and the family and friends started to try to make inquiries to locate Michael and find out where he had been. We think that between 10:45 p.m. on Sunday the 8th and 5:30 on Monday the 9th of May, that during that time something bad has happened to Michael in terms of either causing him to leave the house or that subsequently resulted in his death. On Tuesday the 10th, the family had been unable to locate anybody who had heard of Michael since that call to his partner, and they reported his disappearance to police and police commenced an investigation. The following day on the 11th, the brothers found Michael's car in Chanel Street, and police were advised and obviously attended the car. A forensic response has subsequently been deployed to both Michael's house and the car, and they've both been forensically examined. I can tell you that his car was unopened. Correction, his car was open, but his house was locked and secure, and there was no obvious signs of disturbance, and his phone and wallet was there. There's a number of things we need to know. This is a very difficult and challenging investigation, and we need people to contact us who have any information at all about Michael Modesti, his current lifestyle, and anything that may relate in any way to his disappearance. We're trying to build a complete picture of his friends, his associates, and his life over the last 3 months, and hopefully what his plans were for the future. And we believe that by doing that, it will assist our investigation greatly. We would also like anybody who has any information about any illegal activity that Michael may have been involved in, or any debts he may have had to anybody. Just making that clear, any information that anybody might have in respect to any illegal activity that Michael may or may not have been involved in, or any debts that he may have had for any reason to any person. And we also want to identify anybody who has any information at all about Michael's trip to Thailand and who may have been involved in that venture with him. This afternoon we have gone and spoken to the Modesti family, and as you would imagine, they're naturally devastated, and they've asked that they have no approaches from the media as they grapple with the circumstances they now find themselves in. They did say a few words, and I'll convey that to you now. We love Michael very much. He's a good boy, and we want him back. If you know anything at all about Michael, please tell the police so we can bring him home. And I'm free to any questions.
Do you believe he was importing drugs from Thailand?
We don't know. He's gone to set up a business. There was a building expo, so we have no idea. There is no doubt that he went there to attend an expo relating to importing silicon, which is used in the tiling industry, and he was a tiler. So he could have a completely legitimate reason for buying a product like that overseas at a cheap rate, importing it into Australia and selling it for a profit.
What else do you know that makes you think it may be drug related?
Just there's some of the things that I can't discuss with you, but there are things that make us believe that it may be associated with drug trafficking in the Western Suburbs.
If the strike you referred to that he was involved in between 2002 and 2006, that is drug related?
The only drug-related charge he had was for having 9 small seedlings in 2014. But I can tell you that those 9 seedlings weren't part of any, or there was no obvious signs of any sophisticated drug operation. It was 9 very small seedlings being grown at his house.
Police have any suspects at this time?
We have no indication at all at this stage who may be responsible for Michael's disappearance and what we believe to be the same.
So does this make your investigation very difficult at this stage?
Look, all of our investigations start off very difficult, and what happens normally is we do appeals like this to the public. We speak to everybody, and in the majority of our cases, we get people to assist us willingly, sometimes reluctantly, and then once we get a small break in the investigation, things generally unfold quite quickly.
Have you found any other evidence since the search of the house and the car, which was over a week ago now?
We're still waiting on some of the results of the forensic work that gets done, but it was a very thorough examination of his vehicle, of his house, but at the moment we don't have the result. We don't have the results of it.
Has there been any sign that his bank account or personal accounts have been accessed by anyone?
No, there's no activity at all that we can find to indicate any sign of life activity, whether it be telephone calls, messages, sending letters to anybody, withdrawing accounts, you know, nothing like that at all.
Is everyone cooperating that you've spoken with the moment?
Yeah, well, it's difficult to know because in a disappearance like this, it's very hard to know at the outset who's telling you the truth and who isn't. I suspect that it would be reasonable to believe that there are some people that we've spoken to. If Michael was involved in illegal activity, or if indeed some of those people are involved in an illegal activity, they may be reluctant to be completely truthful to us when we first speak to them. But we would hope over time, as we increase our interaction with those people, that they do the right thing, and that's often the case. If people have a fear of coming forward, a fear of telling us something because they're worried about getting into trouble, we can always speak to those people and navigate our way through it.
Okay.